Lowe again. Our guest today is a noted actor who has been impressing audiences in a wide variety of roles for 5 decades now. It is with great pride we introduce you to the very popular and talented Tony Curtis. And now, he is your puckish man of the half hour, Skip E. Lowe.
You know, when I was a little boy in New York City, I grew up in New York, in Lower East Side in New York, on Cherry Street. Cherry Street. That is around Halsted. I used to work on Halsted Street in the Bowery called Sammy's Bowery Follies. And I was like the singing newsboy for Sammy Fuchs and Betsy. And growing up, I remember there was a guy around my neighborhood was called Tony Curtis, a great actor. I think you came from my neighborhood, Tony, didn't you? Are you born in Bronx?
I went to an acting school down in the neighborhood you just mentioned.
You did?
The New School of Social Research, the Piscata School of Acting, which was on Houston Street.
Right.
Not too far from Sammy's...
Bowery Follies.
Bowery Follies. Is that where you started?
I started there as a child.
You know, born and raised in Manhattan?
I came here as a child, but I went back... Yeah, yes, I love New York.
Yes, I was born and raised in New York.
But you were born in Bronx, weren't you?
No, Manhattan. No?
They always say the Bronx.
I lived in the Bronx for about 6 months.
Oh, is that what they...
I was back in Manhattan, lived in Queens for a little while.
Your father was a tailor.
My father was a tailor from Hungary.
Tell me about the settlement. That was a settlement kind of a theater you did, wasn't it?
Well, there was the Henry Street settlement.
That's correct.
I did, but that was those adventures were only created by me to give me some other look at life.
Right.
Life was so insular living in New York City, born and raised there,
right,
coming from an immigrant family, Hungarian Jews,
yes,
very limited in its scope, do you know?
Of course.
There was a dichotomy for me. On one hand, I lived in this very charming Hungarian environment.
Right.
And then when I went out in the streets, it was a jungle. New York City was a jungle. So that combination is what shaped me and made me be the person that I am.
Yes. But you got into the Navy. You went right to the Navy. How long were you in the Navy?
I was in the Navy 3 years. I went in when I was about 17. Never left Manhattan until that time.
Really?
Went practically around the world to Tokyo. Saw the signing of the peace treaty. Came back to New York City when I went to acting school for a year. I used my GI Bill of Rights. Somebody from Universal, a guy named Bob Goldstein, saw a play I was in called Golden Boy. And the next thing I know,
Hollywood.
I'm here in California on my 22nd birthday.
On your 22nd, Universal signed you up.
7-year contract, right.
Signed you up, 7 years.
I didn't have to kiss anybody, kiss anything, go with anybody. I just got in the movies.
But you worked the Catskills. Tell me about the Catskills. I don't want to know about that.
The Stanley Wolf Players.
Yes, that's what I want to know
the
about.
The Stanley Wolf Players was
I worked
small,
the Catskills, too.
Yes?
Yeah.
Stanley Wolf Players was a small, non-equity company that traveled from hotel to hotel.
Right.
And we would do 2 acts of a play or a play cut down to under 90 minutes, an hour tops. And the play we did in New York at these hotels was This Too Shall Pass, which had a Jewish background
for,
because so many of the people that went up to the Catskills were Jews, and that was a Jewish, what would you
the
say?
The Borscht Circuit.
The Borscht Circuit. So a lot of people started up there. And so I went up there in 19. I got out of the Navy in 46 and the 45. I went up there at the end of 46. 47, I was in New York City at the school, and then summer of 48, I came to California.
When you first arrived, signing with Universal, Tony Curtis, you were 22, star overnight. You were just a sexy-looking, good, dark-looking guy.
That was the whole basis of my career at the beginning.
Sex.
My looks.
Looks. You really think so?
Oh, absolutely.
I thought you were a wonderful actor
from
the beginning.
Well, acting, you know, acting is an experience that happens to you when you play a part.
Right.
Do you see? At 22 years old, I did the best job a 22-year-old
man could do. Right.
Now, some are more advanced than others. I'll give you a good example. Marlon Brando was a lot more intellectually driven than all of us little ding-dongs at that time. So Marlon brought to his parts that quality. That don't mean it's good and that don't mean it's bad, because if you look at Marlon today, he is in more trouble than anybody, unable to come to grips with who he is and what he is. So you see, acting is not necessarily a gift as much as it is a being, to be. To be 23, to be 27, to play a Boston Strangler at 37, to be the son of Alibaba when you're 24. You see, that's the way it's got to grow.
Yes, that's the way
you have to put it together. You can't try to control it.
Yes, yes.
You see, egos demand the control.
Yes.
Marlon does. Barbara Streisand demands the control. Elvis did. But Elvis, you see, in a way didn't, because the general?
Parker took care of him.
Huh?
Colonel Parker.
Yeah, but Colonel was his ego
his
and was
ego.
Able to do
That's,
it for
yes,
him.
Yes,
see?
Yes.
There's so many actors.
Did you have someone like Colonel Parker behind Tony Curtis?
Yes, I did. Lou Wasserman.
He was,
Yes, Lou was my mentor when I first got to, when I first came out to California, I was already under contract.
Right.
And now in 48, I met Mr. Wasserman. I met Lou in the end of 49.
Right.
And I signed with MCA then and became the most important player that they had.
Right.
And all under the guidance of Lou Wasserman.
Sweet Smell of Success. Tell me about that film.
That film was made. We made that after we did Trapeze, Bert and I, which was a huge success.
Trapeze was done in Paris.
Yes.
In Pigalle.
And also Cirque d'Hiver was the circus we used.
Tony, tell me about your Trapeze.
Oh.
That was you, really?
That was me, almost in all of the work. But Bert and I went to Paris 4 months before the picture started, and we worked out together.
But he was a trapeze.
Well, he wasn't a trapeze person as much as he was an acrobat in a circus. He could work on the high bars, you know.
Yes, yes.
So he was. He had that background.
Yes.
I didn't. But Bert was one of the finest men I've ever known. And he made it possible for me to learn as much as I could in 4 months, which I did.
Uh-huh.
You know, we lived at the circus, Bert and I. We lived at the circus. We lived at the George Sank,
which is not a circus. Right.
But we were at the circus every day, you know, living in that environment.
Right.
And that's where I got a good glimpse of what my profession was about.
Tony Curtis, I'm looking at you. The favorite picture of all mine, define one.
Wonderful movie.
One of my favorites.
Yes, wonderful movie.
You got nominated for that.
I got nominated for it.
And what did
But that was no big deal, excuse me.
It wasn't?
They nominated Sidney Poitier and I. They split that vote. That was like a token vote. And I didn't particularly like
that?
It. I do. I didn't particularly like it. I mean, it was all right, you know. But I don't believe in the awards as many.
You don't?
I don't believe in any of these award shows.
You don't?
They're given because of press agents' power, the players' power, buying ads in the trade papers, buying ads in newspapers.
And their friends vote.
And listen, there's nothing wrong with that. Do you know?
Yes.
That's the genre. That's the attitude of the movie. Cary Grant was my friend, and he told me that when the Academy Award first started in the 30s, they'd all go to the Coconut Grove, the Ambassador Hotel.
Right.
And somebody would get up and say, Spencer Tracy, come on up. You gave such a good year this year. We'd like to give you this little award. It was laid back. It was like a dinner.
Yes.
Given for the industry, for each other. Mm-hmm. You know, there was no television. There was no radio.
Yes.
It was just an evening of joy and pleasure.
It was
of
not
camaraderie.
An ego,
and giving. Now the Academy is a big multi-million dollar business. So is AFI. So are all of these shows, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And for me, they've lost the very essence of what they were made to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yes.
But again, that's not a criticism. It's only my observation. You see?
Tony,
Granny's last night was a perfect example.
Yes. I'm looking at you. You have learned a lot in life, it
I
seems.
Do what?
You have learned a lot in life since you've been out here in Hollywood.
Yeah, I probably have.
What has been the hardest for Tony Curtis since you've been out here?
Please.
What has been the hardest for you?
Well, I had a very difficult time, maybe 20 years ago, maybe a little earlier than that. I wasn't getting the parts I wanted. MCA, who was my agency, became my boss at Universal.
Right.
So Lou Wasserman, whose ear and whose guidance I had,
right,
was now my boss instead of my agent. So that changed the tempo of a lot of things. And I wasn't really very happy in my marriages, you know?
Three marriages.
Yeah, four marriages.
Four? Is it?
Shows you what little I know.
Christine.
I don't remember
Kaufman.
The wives. Oh, okay. I only remember the children.
How many children do you have?
I don't remember how many.
You don't?
Yeah, I do. I had six. I lost a son to a heroin overdose 3 years ago. His
Wonderful.
Name was Nicholas.
Yes.
I had two sons. I have one son now, Benjamin, and four daughters.
You stopped completely drinking and taking things in life, you know, Tony Curtis.
Well, I went through the Betty Ford Center because of my abuse of cocaine, smoking cocaine, and excessive amount of drinking.
Why do you think Hollywood, it's always that Hollywood thing?
Hollywood's got nothing to do with it.
It doesn't?
Absolutely nothing. You could get bummed out living in Pasadena.
Yes.
What about Walla Walla, Washington?
Yes.
What about Chicago? You name it.
Yes.
You know, it is not. It's a disease. It's something that we cannot deal with. When life's adversities become so overloaded,
right,
our circuits are so impossible to function.
Yes.
You need a sleeping pill to sleep. You need something to calm you down. You need two, three shots of whiskey to kind of ease your stomach. You need whatever substances you're using, skipping. And then all of a sudden you say, what wife? What kids? What job? What agent?
Uh-huh.
What am I so worried about? Let me sit back and enjoy it. And you enjoy that euphoria,
yes,
of the abuse of substances, but only, for a little while.
Uh-huh.
Then it begins to eat you.
Mm.
And destroy you. And that happens all over the place. In Hollywood here, it is particularly noticeable because of those miserable tabloids who,
yes,
who make...
lies. It's all lies.
Well, they're lies and some of it are truth. But you see, we seem to imagine that fame, with it comes character assassination.
Right.
So the more famous you become, the more... vulnerable you are,
yes,
to being called whatever name they think that will demean you. You know?
Yes, yes. Tony Curtis, I'm looking at you right now, too, and you seem like, you paid your dues. I hate to use that word, pay the dues.
Yeah, right.
But you've learned life, and now you're satisfied, and you're going out. You have a beautiful lady.
Beautiful lady,
seeing,
friend.
Very tall and glorious.
Beautiful.
She's good for you. You seem good for each other.
She is good for me.
What makes her so good for you, Tony?
Well, her sense of who she is. Do you know?
Yes.
We're very much alike. There is no ego problem between us. Jill doesn't want to be an actress.
Uh-huh.
And so, therefore, that is not a problem. That can be a problem. Was a problem. But with Jill, it isn't. She's the most charming and delightful woman. I love her very much, and we're very good friends, and we've known each other now for 3 years. We live together now three
uh-huh.
years, you know,
uh-huh.
and it's been a unique experience for me. For the first time in my life, I have met a woman that I could spend time with. I'm not now deprecating other women that I lived with.
Right.
That had nothing to do with it. I wasn't prepared then.
You're,
you know, I had
yes.
no business getting married. For the first
Janet
27
Lee.
Times.
Janet Lee was your first, wasn't she? Janet?
Yeah,
yes.
I think so.
You fell in love doing a movie together, didn't you?
No.
No?
I don't remember what happened, but it must
You
have
don't
been
remember
right.
what happened to him?
I remember what
yes,
happened.
Yes, yes.
But that's not part of my psyche.
I see.
You know?
I see.
I'm not avoiding it.
Yes.
It just has no pertinent...
I see. Well...
It has nothing to do with me as I sit here talking to you. Today,
right now,
at whatever time it is, we are.
Yes,
you
yes,
know?
I see.
And I live in the present.
You live in the present.
You know, I've made 120 movies in my
120.
Life.
I want to get back to one.
Go ahead.
Some Like It Hot.
Some
Marilyn
Like It Hot,
Marilyn Monroe.
Yes.
You were brilliant in that
Thank
movie.
You.
Brilliant.
It was a wonderful film.
How did Tony Curtis feel dressing as a woman. You and Jack Lemmon.
I liked it.
Did you?
Jill lets me use her dresses every now and then. We don't go out yet. But one of these days, I'll throw a shawl around my head and go skipping out. That was a nice experience.
Marilyn Monroe.
Marilyn Monroe was a... I knew Marilyn 10 years earlier. Mm-hmm. I met her in... I got to California 48. We met in 49 and worked together in 57. So we were chums in those early years that we didn't see each other, then we did the film.
59.
Yeah, by the time... No, 57, we worked together.
Oh, okay.
By the time we did that film, Marilyn had been through a lot of changes.
Right.
A lot of difficulties, you know? Uh-huh. And she was going to get even with all the guys that took advantage of her in those early years in movies, you know? Uh-huh. And that was part of her madness and her unhappiness, you know? She could never come to grips with what she was and who she was. So therefore, she drank a lot, used a lot of drugs, substances. And please, believe me when I tell you, I grew up with her. I know all about her.
She was not murdered by the Kennedys.
She was not murdered by the Kennedys, by the Mafia, or anybody.
Thank you, Tony.
Marilyn, she didn't even kill herself. She wasn't... She tried to commit suicide a number of times.
It's just accident.
But what she would do...
Yes.
As soon as she felt the buzz of whatever she was using, those pills...
Yes.
She'd pick up the phone and call somebody, say, you better come over. And she would drop the phone, somebody'd come over, and they'd revive her, take her to the hospital. The last time, there was no one around. It was an accident. She tried to call, but no one picked up the phone.
No, picked up the phone. And she just slid away.
It's a tragedy. It's a tragedy for Marilyn. Forget about the Kennedys. Forget about Sam Giancana. Forget about all these other people all around her. They had nothing to do with it. Absolutely nothing to do with it. You
Son
know?
Of Alibaba, a young man from Bronx doing
Son
with
of
wonderful
Alibaba.
Accents. You were wonderful. Just flying away up there.
I loved it.
Son of Alibaba. Enjoy doing that film.
Yes. The first movie was Prince Who Was a Thief.
Yes.
I did a couple of small parts in a lot of movies around that time.
Right.
Then I got a lot of fan mail at the studio, and so they decided they would put me in a lead of a film. And 18 months from the day I started in movies, I was 20, 22 and a half maybe. Yeah, almost 23. I did the Prince Who Was a Thief with Piper Laurie.
And good actress.
But, you know, those pictures, Skippy, in those days were made for $120,000, $30,000.
Is that all they were made for?
And then they went out and grossed $2.5 million. In those days, a ticket was 35 cents. So that kind of comparable prices today would be a film cost $20 million to make, it grosses $150 million. Uh-huh. So it was... I was big time for the studio then.
Right, of course.
Every picture I was in grossed $2.5-3 million. Uh-huh. That's a big grosser for a 35, 50 cents movie ticket.
Universal Studios was a good studio, wasn't it?
It was. It was much better than any of the other studios for young players.
That's right.
Although it didn't make the most important pictures. Uh-huh. MGM did, Columbia did, Warner Brothers.
Frank Sinatra did do a movie at
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Yeah, what was that
Meet
first
Me Wilson.
Me, I was in it with Jeff Chandler.
That's
we
correct.
Played a bit in it.
Tell me about Jeff Chandler.
He was a wonderful man. He was one of the stubborn, opinionated.
But he died so strangely.
He died for no reason.
For an his appendix legs, or something?
No, his legs were bothering him. He had been on somewhere and had to work, and he was having trouble with his lower back.
Uh-huh.
And I spoke with him a week or so before he went into the hospital. He said, I'm going to get my spine fused so I could... He had to go back to work. He had child support payment. People were after him. He was in debt.
Uh-huh.
And I spoke to a doctor who said, listen, tell your pal to go in a traction for about 6 weeks. Mm-hmm. He says, I can't, Tony. I got another movie to make. And during that operation... they closed him up and found they had left something inside there. Opened him up. He was under that kind of condition for about 10, 12 hours and died, poor man. 36.
You were very close, you and him.
Spartacus. Handsome, charming.
Yes, man. Spartacus, Tony. Tell me about Kirk Douglas and you in Spartacus.
I did two pictures with Kirk. I've done two pictures with almost all of these people.
All these actors.
Yeah, I did Spartacus and The Vikings.
The
with
Vikings,
Kirk.
Yes.
I also did a bit for him in a movie called The List of Adrian Messenger, where a whole slew of us worked in.
Right.
Kirk, I met him early. Now, we both started about the same time, although he and Bert were 10 years older than I. We all started in 40, they started 46, 47. I started in 48. So we were newcomers, so to speak.
But you three were very close.
Well, we were very close.
Yes.
Kirk and Bert were very much alike. Uh-huh. I liked both men. Kirk was much more assertive.
Assertive, yeah.
you know? Mm-hmm. He was much more, you couldn't fool too much with Bert. I mean, he looked, I mean, with Kurt.
With Kurt.
But underneath it all, there was an Iron Man who was, you know.
But he did have a sense of humor.
Oh, definitely, yes. And Bert, on the other hand, was a dichotomy of Kirk. Uh-huh. They were very much alike. Most amusing, both men, you know.
Rat Race, tell me about that.
Debbie Reynolds.
Debbie Reynolds. Oh. Working with Debbie. Come on.
I did two pictures with her. Goodbye Charlie at MGM with Vincent Minnelli. Uh-huh. And The Great Race with Robert Mulligan directed.
Right.
And it was a wonderful movie.
Favorite director?
Vincent Minnelli.
I knew that.
Dick Quine.
Mm, Richard Quine.
He was a fabulous
director. We just lost him recently.
Huh?
Did we lose Richard?
Oh, we lost him, a little while back,
He was a wonderful director,
wasn't
he?
Oh, what a...
What made him so wonderful for Tony Curtis?
Well, you know, he started... If you watch some of the early movies, you'll see him appearing in those early Mickey Rooney movies.
Yes.
As the second or third young leading man. So he had a whole career of playing second parts in these movies and built a wonderful experience so that one day when he decided to be a director, he had the flair and the sense of it.
Yeah. Tony Curtis, director someday?
Never.
Ooh, you use that word, never, so quick.
Never say never. But no, I'm not interested in directing or producing films.
Really?
I rather enjoy the idea that I show up with my footlocker, salute whoever I'm going to work with, uh-huh. Step in like a member of the Foreign Legion, do my work, and get out of there.
Sex and the Single Girl. Come on, tell me about
Natalie
that.
Wood.
Natalie Wood. Wonderful
we
girl.
We had Natalie Wood.
You were very close with
Henry
her.
Fonda. We had Lauren Bacall.
Right.
Mel Ferrer. I was close with that.
Natalie tell me about was Natalie.
Natalie, we did three pictures together,
right.
You know. And we got to be great, great friends.
I know.
We didn't have any other relationship, Natalie and I. Mm-hmm. It was always, we always, for some reason, we were attracted to each other, but never to a point that we would wanted to have you know.
Tony Curtis never had really relationships with their leading ladies, Tony?
Wouldn't say that.
Well, Janet Leigh.
The only one, the only leading lady that I didn't have an affair with was Jack Lemmon.
Okay. Working with Jack Lemmon, tell me about that great man. I really love
him. No, Jack's an excellent actor.
Yes.
Yeah, excellent. Very intuitive, gives a great deal of himself. You know, there isn't any actor I worked with that didn't do that.
Uh-huh.
You know? Even in the worst times with Marilyn, when that was the most difficult period of time for her, there was an ingenuousness.
Yes.
There was a delicateness about her, you know? Uh-huh. Now, you know, you got to die before they say something nice about you. So all of a sudden, Marilyn and Elvis and Jimmy Dean and all of these players that died earlier than they should have now become icons and become buildings that we have to live up to. When in reality, they are money-making machines. Mm-hmm. Each one of them got some businessman somewhere is collecting all that dough while he's selling Elvis's T-shirts.
When did Tony Curtis become really got interested in art as since a child?
Yes.
Colors, you're an artist.
I should have brought my paintings, but
that's okay.
Maybe next time.
Yeah.
I've always been a painter. All my life.
Really?
And that's part of my expression.
Uh-huh.
I'm not a celebrity artist. I don't like that connotation. I know butchers that paint.
Uh-huh.
I know camera people that paint.
Yes.
I know cab drivers that paint. Uh-huh. I know actors that paint. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't make it any more special. Sure, the name is a little better known, but.
Right.
If anybody will buy a painting of mine just for my signature, they're silly, because I'll give you an autograph. I'll autograph anything for anybody.
But the color, your colors.
My colors. Well, I use colors as shapes.
Yes.
And the amount of color I use depends a great deal on what the other color is.
Uh-huh.
So a balance of yellow and blue, for an example.
Uh-huh.
Do you need a lot of blue or a little amount of blue against a bigger form of yellow?
Yes.
So I won't say an abstractionist, but a colorist. Uh-huh. I use colors. There's enough in my paintings to remind you of a floral arrangement.
Yes.
But that's the only inkling you have. After that, the colors
How long does it take you to do a painting?
I can do a painting in 3-4 hours.
Really?
And I let it dry, and then I look
What's your day like, Tony? You get up early in the morning or late afternoon?
I'm up early every morning.
You are?
Yes, right. Up early every morning. Take care of whatever business I have to do on the phone, because you could get to New York and I can speak to Europe then.
Mm-hmm.
I have a number of friends and things I do then. And then from about 10:30 to 11:30, 12, I paint or take care of my clothing, or get my car washed.
Clothing. You're talking about clothing. You and Cary Grant. You are a chic, sophisticated dresser.
Clothes
you
mean
love
a lot
clothes.
To me. I do. Did you notice my medals?
Yes, I'm looking at your medals. Tell me
this
about
one,
that.
This one is a Hungarian medal.
Those are emeralds.
It's given to me by given to me by the Hungarian Republic merit for my help in establishing and making Hungarians better known. My parents were Hungarian,
yes,
and they were kind enough to give me that about a year ago.
Beautiful.
And the one below it is called the Chevalier,
yes,
the Order of Arts and Letters, given to me by the French government for my paintings and for my films. They're both knighthoods.
Beautiful.
So that gives me makes me a, two nights in a row.
Two nights in a row, yes.
I'm working for the full week.
Tony, those emeralds are gorgeous.
The what?
The emeralds.
Yeah, they're beautiful, aren't they? Yeah.
Absolutely beautiful
Thank
emeralds.
Thank you.
Beautiful. Tony Curtis.
Tell me.
What's your philosophy in life? I'm getting it now, boy.
Yeah.
You're really giving it to me. But what is your philosophy?
Just sitting here with you, looking at you, Skippy.
You're very,
trying
you seem
to
very,
you get
seem
from
very
you
a simple man. You've seen you... You enjoy life.
Yeah,
you don't take it serious anymore.
I find nothing
anymore.
Complicated.
Nothing complicated?
No, nothing complicated.
How do you handle
I
that?
I just don't do it. I just won't fall into that complication. Do you know?
This is a very dangerous world out there, Tony.
It certainly is. But
you turn
listen,
the news on.
I'm a tough kid. Nobody's going to get me, you know?
Uh-huh.
When, you know, mankind is so full of shit. You know, we have so devastated each other over the countless years that we've been around here. We've been bumping each other off because of our color,
yes,
because of our religion, because of our neighborhood, because of the north, the south, the east, the west. I mean, we haven't developed at all. What have we done? Yeah, we got little nice watches now. We got television.
Yes.
We've got air conditioning. You know, a whole slew of nice things that we can.
Mm-hmm.
I got driver's gloves because I drive a nice car. But the relationships of people are still antagonistic. We are still envious of each other. We still hate each other for whatever the reason is. And, you know, we must obliterate that in our system. Mm-hmm. For a nation like Germany to have murdered 6 million people,
yes,
1 million children, to be responsible for 26 million people.
Of course.
How many young black people came to this country as slaves? How many of them have been obliterated? What about Bosnia? What about the Armenians?
Right.
What about? I mean, you know, this world is so out of it, it's out of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so we mustn't take it too seriously.
Yes, yes.
You've got to be kind and sweet with everybody. Give me five.
I see you all the time around town, and you are always greeting people. Kindness.
I am. I have a
you
good
are,
time.
Tony Curtis, you're that way.
My dear friend, listen, no one is... I've had an extraordinary success in my life. And
so
it's still going on.
You know? Yes.
And as long as I can stay on my feet and stay healthy, it will continue to.
If you were not an actor, what would you have done?
I don't know.
You don't?
Let's examine it carefully.
Yeah.
I'm an actor.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a painter.
Yes.
I'm an author. I'm a businessman. I'm a father. I'm an excellent friend.
Huh? That's wonderful.
When I grow up, I'm going to be a doctor. I'm not sure what kind of medicine I'm going to practice yet.
Tony Curtis, you wrote a book.
Yes.
Several years ago.
Yes.
What was it called, that book?
Ken Andracone and Julie Sparrow. That was a novel. Then I did my autobiography a couple of years ago.
Mae West, working with Mae West. Her last movie, Sex Tech.
Yes.
Great.
She was a piece of work.
She was.
Yeah.
But you played that Alexei,
the Russian ambassador to the United
wonderful,
Nations.
Wonderful.
She wrote a lot of the dialogue. She was very amusing.
Was she?
I said to her at one point, my darling, do you remember the songs I used to sing to you on the Elba in my native tongue? She said, I don't remember.